بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الدين عند الله الإسلام. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، pertama sekali kita panjatkan kesyukuran kita kepada Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. Salam dan selawat ke atas baginda Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Dan saya berharap sahabat-sahabat semua telah pun menikmati makan malam dan juga solat isyak bersama dengan ahli keluarga yang tersayang. Dan sebelum kita pergi lebih lanjut, kita juga mendoakan agar kesejahteraan dan kesihatan serta kesembuhan kepada semua insan, sama ada Muslim ataupun yang belum Muslim, yang terkesan ataupun dijangkiti virus COVID-19, agar mereka segera dikurniakan kesembuhan oleh Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala dan dikurniakan kesabaran kepada ahli keluarga dan waris-waris mereka. Baik, sahabat-sahabat, tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, muslimin dan muslimat yang dirahmati oleh Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, sebelum saya memperkenalkan dan membawakan panel kita pada malam ini, seperti biasa, jangan lupa untuk share, untuk tag kawan-kawan, ajak ramai-ramai, termasuk yang belum Muslim, ajak mereka tengok. Okey, ajak mereka tengok. Okey, kerana malam ini kita tetamu khas. Setiap hari, setiap sesi adalah tetamu khas. Siapakah tetamu khas kita? Tetamu khas kita bolehlah kita kategorikan sebagai beauty with brain. Ha, tu dia. Apa yang dimaksudkan dengan beauty with brain ni? Kita kan santai-santai kan, beauty with brain, sebab kadangkala kita kata ada orang dia cantik, tapi kadangkala perangai dia hodoh, kelayakannya tak ada. Tetapi yang ni kita kata sebagai beauty with brain. Okay, kenapa beauty with brain? Saya akan qualify. Kerana kalau kita lihat, beliau memeluk Islam pada tahun 2013. Okay, 8 tahun. Alhamdulillah. Tetapi perjalanan hidupnya itu yang kita nak kongsikan. Di mana tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, sahabat-sahabat, beliau, kenapa saya kata beauty with brain, antaranya, ada banyak sebab, antaranya ialah beliau bukan hanya ada rupa paras, kerana beliau bekas peserta dalam Miss Teen USA, Nun, jauh di USA, bukan Ulu Selangor, ini USA, United States of America, bukan Ulu Selangor, US, okay? Dan beliau juga merupakan top 5 participants dalam Miss Teen Thailand. Masya Allah, nanti kita akan dengar dia Sawadi Cup, Kapung Cup, ha, semua tu insya Allah. Nanti dia akan keluar Tom Yam, siakapnya semua insya Allah. Okay, mana tahu ada nasi paprik, nasi pataya, ya, kita akan keluar sekali insya Allah. Ya, sampai santai-santai, tapi kita sampai. Bukan itu saja, tetapi beliau juga mempunyai double BA dalam sosiologi dan juga ekonomik. Double BA, tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, bukan main-main. Bukan saja double BA, tetapi beliau juga mempunyai MBA dalam international business. Bukan itu saja, beliau bukan masuk Islam lalu ikut sahaja tanpa belajar. Tidak, tetapi beliau mempunyai diploma dalam Islamic Studies dari Aris University. Dan kini, alhamdulillah, beliau bertugas, baru saja memulakan tugas sebagai Women Empowerment Specialist di Multiracial Rewarded Muslim, MRM. So, dan tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, sesi kita pada malam ni santai. Kita akan ada pelbagai bahasa. Saya akan bercakap dalam bahasa Melayu dan saya akan mewawancara beliau dalam bahasa English. Beliau akan bercakap dalam bahasa English dan juga mungkin bahasa Thailand. Yeah. Dan kemudian insyaAllah saya akan simpulkan buat rumusan untuk memudahkan kita faham. Yang tak kurang faham English, no problem. Beliau akan faham insyaAllah. Beliau akan memudahkan kita. Jadi without further ado, let us welcome Sister Aliza Kim. Assalamualaikum, Aliza.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Masya Allah, I'm sweating from your introduction, listening to the whole thing.
You did understand Malay, right?
I understood only because it was mixed in with English words.
because I mix it with tom yam, siakap, pataya. And if I'm not mistaken, I have heard from you personally, from you, no less than 3 or 4 times that you cook the best tom yam around, isn't it?
I mean, people have told me that they're into my tom yam, so I'll take their word for it.
Okay. Okay. I would not comment on the food part because I haven't tried it yet. Okay, I think it has been more than 2 years that we didn't met one another.
More than 2 years for sure. More than two years.
Yeah. Alhamdulillah, and you know, because of the COVID, and then we start to keep in touch. Alhamdulillah, and now we welcome you on board in MRM, Multiracial Reverted Muslim, as our Women's Empowerment Specialist. And I think today, tonight, we have a lot of audience with us, and I would love to believe as well that there might be some of our not yet Muslim brothers and sisters who are watching silently, just to hear your story. I mean, for them, it's like people is talking about Islam is oppressing women, Islam discriminate women. But yet, here we are, we have a woman, or as I said just now, beauty with brain. Someone who have a double BM in sociology as well and in economic, as well as having a master in international business. And yet, she choose to become a Muslim. So why not, Aliza, share with our audience tonight a bit about your background, you know, where you were born, and then how come you end up here in Malaysia? Please.
Okay. Alhamdulillah. As some of you know, my name is Aliza Kim. I'm Thai American. Alhamdulillah. So that means I was definitely born in America. And I think you can hear from my voice too, I'm born in America. I was born in a very small town in Oklahoma. So basically, I'm a cowgirl. I remember when I was very, very small, our entertainment was going to the local farm and watching sheep being born. That was fun. and then after that, I moved to a slightly bigger town, but still in the middle of the wilderness in New Hampshire. So I went from farms to big, big trees and lots of snow. And then I ended up in Boston, actually a suburb of Boston called Newton. And Newton is really where I settled down with my mother most of the time. I finished my elementary school, junior high school, and also college there. I went to Boston College, alhamdulillah. It was a beautiful campus. And the special thing about Boston College is actually because it's a Jesuit college, and we still had those monks with the brown robes. They were still teaching there. So some of them were my professors. And there's an interesting story that actually helped my reversion from there as well. Maybe I'll share that later. After Boston College, I moved to Denver to get my master's degree. And in Denver, I had my heart seriously broken, moved back to my mother. And then my father was like, well, since you're done with your master's and you're heartbroken, how come you don't come to Thailand? So I decided, okay, I'll go to see my dad in Thailand. Just for, you know, a month or two, the regular summer deal that I usually did, and ended up that I enjoyed myself so much that I stayed until money ran out. And after money ran out, I was thinking, what can I do? And one of the first things that I saw on TV was a TV commercial for entering the Miss Thailand pageant. So it wasn't Miss Teen USA, it was like the adult version. I did Miss Teen USA in Massachusetts, and now this was the adult version of Miss Thailand. So I was like, Miss Thailand sounds kind of interesting. That's like a free vacation for at least 8 weeks. And since Dad is going to be away for a business trip and I have no money at the moment, maybe I'll do that. And so I went in. And I'm actually a very petite girl. I'm like 5'3", something like that. And usually like beauty queens are like 5'7". So everyone's like super tall. So I remember like the ladies that were taking care of me for the pageant, they would tease my hair up so that I looked taller. So anyway, I went in. I went all the way to the top five. I'm not really sure why. Maybe just because I talk a lot, so I express. I always assume it's because I talk a lot and I express, so I get myself through things. So then after that, that was an interesting experience. And then I actually went back to business. I started working for a British company, doing the whole corporate thing, but at a very young age. So I was 24, and I was put as a senior manager, and no one listened to me. So I was only in that job for about, I don't know, a year. And I figured out, okay, Thailand works on seniority. So this is not going to work out for me at this age. So I went back to what I thought I could do at that time, which was, you know, the whole modeling and all that, because it was just simple for me to get into. Take a few pictures, fly them around, see what happens. So one thing led to another, and then a full-fledged career of about 10 years came through, and also landed me in Malaysia. So I came to Malaysia to shoot a big-budget TV commercial. And because I had done a lot of things in Thailand already, I was already doing the commercials, I had already hosted a TV show, I was already already doing TV dramas in Thailand, all these things. Malaysia was a fresh new market and everyone spoke English. Thai isn't my first language, so English is my first language. So I was like, wow, people speak English here. This is nice. And something, you know, it's a new market that I could, you know, potentially enter. And during that TV commercial shoot, I was invited to stay by the director of photography. They thought that the look would fit into Malaysia well. And alhamdulillah, that's what I did. I started filming a reality show, which was a nightmare. But alhamdulillah, that was my first step into Malaysia. And then once I actually moved here, I found out that Malaysians are very kind, very nice. Malaysia is a very inviting country. And if we're talking about where I reverted in Malaysia. Alhamdulillah, Allah opens my heart here. But my journey really started actually when I was born, my journey to Islam. But I'm sure you can ask me that in a moment. So I'll just finish this part of it. So I decided to stay in Malaysia. It was either Malaysia and Singapore because English, basically. But I found Malaysian lifestyle a little bit slower, a little bit more easygoing, a little bit more, I guess, comfortable for me. So that's how I ended up here.
Okay, interesting. I think the first time we met was like 5-6 years ago, when you just became Muslim not long.
I think it was longer than that. Maybe six years, something like that, because we were on like a panel at Petronas. In some like basement in Petronas.
Yeah, I think that once is in Petronas, and but then we also have another program together in PWTC. PWTC, where the moderator is Amin Idris.
That's right. Yes.
Right, and from there where I got to know you better, and of course then we have a common teachers as well in Sheikh Husseini. We went to the same center. Okay, yep. But we never met there. Right.
Yep.
So alhamdulillah. Just now I heard that. I'm not sure either that is a compliment or what when you say your choice is either Malaysia or Singapore, but end up you settled down in Malaysia because of a bit slower. Is there some sort of compliments to Malaysians?
No, it is. It really depends on how a person feels, right? I've asked like a French person before why they moved to Thailand. They're like, I slept into Thailand and it felt like home. So my Malaysia just felt more comfortable. The pace of life I felt was just more comfortable.
Okay. Now, that's very interesting because from US and then you went to Thailand and then you come to Malaysia and then you go through a lot of your journey. Alhamdulillah. Okay. Please allow me 1 or 2 minutes in order for me to explain to the audience who might not understand English that well, inshallah. Okay. But okay. I think you understand some Malay, right?
Basic.
Again.
Oh, skit. Very sikit.
Nasi lemak, mie goreng, roti canai, teh tarik.
Food is okay.
If you have problem with food, then you have problem settling down in Malaysia. Okay. Okay. Untuk sahabat-sahabat, Aliza, okay, beliau dilahirkan di Oklahoma di USA. Okay, kiranya beliau memperkenalkan diri beliau sebagai seorang cowgirl yang tunggang lembu tu, dengan topi special mereka, dengan boot kulitnya dan sebagainya. Dan beliau dilahirkan, bapaknya seorang rakyat Thailand, orang Thailand, ibunya seorang orang US, sebab itu beliau dilahirkan di situ. Dan kemudian beliau membesar di situ, dan background beliau adalah seorang Christian. Beliau juga telah menyertai Miss Teen USA, kemudian telah pergi ke Thailand untuk dan juga di situ untuk berjumpa dengan ayahnya yang telah terpisah dengan beliau. Selepas itu, dalam prosesnya, beliau merasakan sangat selesa berada di Thailand. Lalu pada usia 24 tahun, beliau telah mula bekerja di Thailand. Tetapi pada usia sangat muda, pada 24 tahun, tidak ramai orang yang begitu mendengar kata-kata beliau. Ya, kerana kalau mengikut apa yang Aliza Kim sebut, itu dari segi budaya di Thailand, mereka akan lebih melihat kepada seniority. Siapakah yang lebih tua? Siapakah yang lebih lama di situ? Maka beliau hanya lebih kurang bertahan lebih kurang setahun dan kemudian beliau kembali ke dalam arena modeling. Dan kerana ada arena modeling itulah yang telah membawa beliau untuk ke Malaysia untuk menjalani satu penggambaran iklan, ya, yang mengambil kos yang besar. Dan beliau waktu itu memilih antara Malaysia dengan Singapura dan akhirnya beliau telah settle down di Malaysia dan alhamdulillah di Malaysia jugalah beliau memeluk Islam. So itu adalah secara ringkas. So I hope I have summarized for them, insyaAllah. Okay, and I think one of the things, like I myself, I'm a revert. You are a revert as well. The difference is you became Muslim in 2013 and I became Muslim in 2005. I think 8 years apart.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
8 years apart. Okay. 8 years apart. Now, I think one of the things that is very interesting that most of the time people want to know is that other than your professional background, they would like to know, how about your religious background before this? I mean, how religious you are? Because some people might say that, you know, people who become Muslim, sometimes they themselves are not very religious in their previous religions. So that's why they lost and then they go to Islam. How about you, in your case? Are you very religious as per se? What religion that you are in searching for the truth? And what really triggered you in the first place?
Okay, so I think we're gonna also launch into my hijra story from this. So actually, of course, in Islam, we know that iman goes up and down, right? So as a Christian, I was a Christian before. I think most of the time I was very religious. Some pockets of time where I was not as religious, and that's where I got lost. But to tell you the truth, my father is a clergyman, so he's actually a minister of the Presbyterian Church. So I grew up with a father who was religious. He was a religious leader, and also he was a missionary. So I remember also him going on missions, and I would follow him on some of these missions as well. And even how I was born in Oklahoma is because he was going to seminary, so he was actually getting his PhD in Christian theology. So I would say that I grew up religious. I was always having a close relationship with God. I never felt that I wasn't with God. I always felt the presence of God around me, whether I was a child or in school or whatever it was. I always knew that there was God. So alhamdulillah for that. And even when I went, like I mentioned, Boston College, it's a Catholic, Jesuit Catholic college. So even there, the religious side was still strong. You know, I went to college, but I also every Tuesday night was the Bible study. And then even the a cappella group that I sang in was the Christian a cappella group. So everything revolved around faith for me, basically. So if we're talking about people thinking that reverts come from a loose religious background, no, some of us were very religious. Yeah, and I knew the stories of the Bible very well. I grew up, I remember starting to be in the church, singing in the children's choir at 2 years old, going to Sunday school in Thailand, going to Sunday school in Oklahoma, going to Sunday school in New Hampshire. So I remember a lot of religion in life. However, one thing, now going into the hijra a little bit, one thing that I realized connecting the dots backwards in my journey to Islam is that even though I grew up in a very religious Christian home, I realized that I've only ever prayed to God the Father. I never prayed to Jesus. I knew that he was special. I knew that he was a special person, and his life was something that we followed. But I realized growing up, you know, even when I took my cross to exams and I would pray before my exam, I always prayed to God the Father. So that is proof to me that Allah has been with me all this while and just guiding me through the motions of the life that I needed to acquire to come to this point in my life. So so that's why I say, like, I feel like the journey of becoming a Muslim started when I was born, because I feel like Allah has always protected me in some small way, you know. And then I got to college, and like I said, I was in these Christian groups and everything. But the interesting thing about the Jesuit college was that we were forced to actually, not forced, it was compulsory. It was a compulsory subject to take theology. So we had to take one theology class and then one elective class, but also in Christian something. So I took theology, and I took Christian art. So art, symbolism, things like that. And I don't remember which class it was, but there was one class that I was very appreciative of the monk that was the priest that was lecturing. He actually taught us that, you know, the original Catholic Bible, the first one, was put together, and it was councils of men that would come and, you know, decide these things and which chapters to put in and take out. And I kept that in my mind, and it must have stayed there for some reason. And I only knew when I began my my research in, I wasn't even researching to become a Muslim. I was actually researching to become a better Christian, but I'll get to that. But anyway, through my research, that fact came back and I was like, oh, actually a Catholic priest told me this when I was 18 years old. And then I remembered, but okay, back to there. So yes, so going through again, that kind of implanted into my mind. And then, okay, so I went through the motions of the whole heartbreak, but I believe that Allah only gave me that heartbreak so that I would move to Asia. So that there was no other reason for me to move to Asia, because I was doing well in school. I graduated top 5% of my MBA. I was invited to be on The Apprentice. Alhamdulillah, I said no. Imagine if I was on The Apprentice. Oh my gosh. Anyway, so I was doing well, I was doing well in America. And the only reason that I left America was because I just wanted to nurse my broken heart. Yeah. So arriving in Thailand, alhamdulillah, I was still, the privileged daughter of one of the well-known pastors in Thailand, alhamdulillah. So still very much in the religious circles, but now from my point of view, now Allah was putting me into situations where I had to develop myself in a different way, because I was already developing myself intellectually, I would say, how to think, how to analyze. Now Allah was putting me into work where I had to develop my character, I guess you could say, and also my speech. So I was on TV, I was in shows, I was on stage, I was in all of these things. And to me, that was to prepare me to be able to speak like how I'm speaking to you now. Being able to speak in front of people eloquently without stuttering, being able to quickly, arrange my thoughts and tell a story or analyze something and deliver my thoughts in a sequence that was intelligible to people. That was all done in Thailand, really, during those years where I was on TV quite a lot. So that Allah put me there to do that. And then He put me in Malaysia through that TV program, or through the commercial. That was the first time that I had really even thought of Malaysia. And I'm so sorry, Malaysians. I'm just like so American. I didn't even know where Malaysia was, even though you're like right next to Thailand in a way, I didn't even know where Malaysia, I didn't even think of Malaysia. It was not in my mind, like not in my radar at all. It didn't have to be on my radar for all that time. And then suddenly, as an adult, Allah puts me here to appreciate the people here, find beauty in the people here, find beauty in the land here. So I eventually moved here for what I thought was, to develop my blooming industrial career in acting and all these things, because then I could branch out into English programs, right? But actually I was put here for Islam to find me. I have this article, my coming out article. It's called The Truth That Found Me, because I wasn't looking for Islam. I wasn't. But Allah is the one that put me into these situations and into these countries and into these places where I would have to meet Muslims, where I would have to notice Islam after some point, right? But to tell you the truth, when I first arrived here, I was oblivious. People ask me, oh, didn't you know that it was an Islamic country? No, I didn't. And I didn't even know much about Muslims, even though, yes, at Boston College, I took a comparative religions course, but Islam was literally 30 minutes. Even when I lived through 9/11 at that time, it didn't occur to me, like I didn't live in this mind space that I was like, oh, Muslims are evil. And I didn't connect that. That wasn't connected. And obviously that was another like protection from Allah, right? It didn't occur to me, because I actually grew up, my father actually taught me that everyone is fine. Everyone gets along, everyone prays differently. So that was always in my mind. That's from Dad. So once I arrived here, just because of maybe the city that I grew up in was kind of colorblind. Boston has so many different types of people, because we have Harvard there, we have MIT there. It's just a melting pot of people from all around the world, So it didn't occur to me that these people who are wearing headscarf are Muslim ladies, or these guys with the long beards are Muslim. It didn't occur. For me, I was like, oh, So that's the fashion here. Yeah, they cover, you know, this is like a fashion, you know, that's what they like. And these men, wow, Malaysian guys really like their beards. All right, manly. You know, so it didn't occur to me at all. I was just like, okay, yeah, that's just how people roll here. That's fine. So it wasn't until I landed myself a role in a Pontianak movie. I did a Pontianak telly movie.
Pontianak Harum Sundal Malam?
I don't know. Anyway, so I was in this Pontiac movie and I was wearing the fangs and all these things, right? And then I noticed come some of the crew during the day, they don't eat, because we were filming actually during Ramadan and we had a Muslim crew and everything. I was like, what's going on? And then some of the women, they were like very shy about eating during the day sometimes, because they're like, no. It's because I'm on my holiday, you know, my holiday. So I'm eating. I'm like, yeah, so just eat. Yeah, so I didn't know. So then I started to, what is going on here? Why are these people acting strange? Yeah, so then I figured, then it kind of clicked. Oh, okay. It must be because of their religious belief. Something's going on. And then it dawned on me, oh, they're Muslim. So oblivious. And so that was kind of like my first light bulb of, oh, there's Muslims here. But then, I mean, this was movie industry Muslims, you know, so perhaps they weren't the best of role models for me to see, because even though I felt that they were nice people, they were okay. A lot of them were very nice, very okay people. It gave me the impression that, oh, if this is what a Muslim is, I don't need to be a Muslim. Why does anyone need to be a Muslim? They're just like everyone else. There's no difference. Yeah, so that's how I felt. There's no difference. So I went along, you know, and finished the movie and felt, okay, what's next? And yeah, so after that, I really started to grow in the industry here. I got a lot of modeling jobs. I got a lot of commercial jobs. I was hosting a lot of events. And this is when, I guess, the sudden growth, interestingly enough, instead of making me feel fulfilled and happy and successful, this is when the real journey began, because I started going into that emptiness. And I'm not saying that I'm so popular or whatever it is, but I can really relate to some of the stories of the Hollywood celebrities where you hear of, you know, someone like Robin Williams, so successful, someone that looks so happy, someone who's always making people laugh and looks like he's laughing himself, but inside is absolutely empty. You know, I started to have those kinds of feelings myself. And I felt very alone, very empty, very unfulfilled of why I'm having this worldly success and I'm growing and, you know, progressing, but inside it's becoming more and more empty. That purpose, that, I don't know, those feelings of just personal satisfaction and knowing who I am, it just wasn't there. And I tell you why. Once you get to a certain place of success in that world, it's as though you don't, your body doesn't belong to you. Your mind doesn't belong to you. What you think, what you say, doesn't matter anymore. Because I remember at the height of that success, I mean, just trimming my nails, I had to report it. I trimmed my nails today, you know, because if I was going to shoot a TV commercial where they needed to do a close-up of my hands, they would need to know, okay, did you trim your nail? Did you do something different? Do we need to bring a manicurist to like do whatever that they do? Or if, you know, I would have to check in every 1 or 2 weeks, whether even if I gained 500 grams, because in the camera, it'll show, because I gain weight on my face, not really anywhere else, my face. So 500 grams will be big cheeks or small cheeks. It depends. Okay. So like, I really felt like, who am I? Even like what I wore or what I eat, it didn't matter. Like I would literally roll out of bed, grab my jeans, grab my hoodie. Hair, combing the hair is optional, because once I get on set, I sit down, someone comes to bring me my clothes, combs my hair, and even the food I eat, I don't choose. I didn't know what I liked to eat. I just ate whatever was there. It's like I was like, who am I? I was completely lost, like every sense of the word lost. I don't know what to eat. I don't know what I'm supposed to look like. I don't know what I'm supposed to wear. I don't know what I'm supposed to think, because all of these things belong to my client. it was nuts, you know? So there was that absolute emptiness. And alhamdulillah, whenever I felt lost in my life, the one thing that I would go back to is religion. So here comes the religious part. So I went and bought like 10 books, so many books until my father was like, Lisa, are you going to seminary? What's going on? What are you doing? So I bought a variety. So I bought books on Christian history, I think two on Christian history, a few on different Christian theories. Like I was wondering how come the Pauline theory and all these things, and I'll tell you about that in a moment. So different types of books. But I really, really was at a point where I didn't know what it felt like to be happy and fulfilled anymore. I didn't know what it felt like, because happy was just, I'm playing my role as this happy mom with a new baby, and so I'm happy. And then when I'm not that mom, I don't know what I'm supposed to feel. I didn't know what happy felt like anymore. So I told God, I don't know who I am, and I don't know what to feel, and I don't know what happy feels. I literally don't know what happy feels like anymore. All I want is to feel like myself, and I don't even have to have continuous happiness. Just remind me what happiness feels like. Just pops of it would be enough. I don't even know what it feels like. So I really wanted to, you know, ground myself in religion so that I would have that again. And I knew somehow that in order to be able to do that, I had to please God. God was the way to have all of that back for me as a human being. I knew that. I don't know how I knew that, but I just knew that. Fitra, we will say fitra in Islam. But at that time I was like, I don't know. I just know that I have to please God. And if I please God, everything will be okay. He'll help me out. So these books that I bought was my attempt at figuring out how to please God. Basically, I wanted to look in the history books and in the manuscripts to find out what was the best way to worship God that would make him the happiest, because I know if he's happy with me, he'll make me happy. I knew that. So I chose books that were basically, I chose books that were not biased or as unbiased as I could find, because I wanted God to guide me myself and not have someone else like lead me to their own thoughts. So even like the Christian history books, I bought books that were written by historians, not Christian historians, just regular historians that will just tell the story like it is. So in those history books, that's where the thing from the monk from Boston College came in again, because I started reading about the history, right? Part of it, I couldn't accept the Crusades, first of all, because the Crusades were very bloody, and I couldn't understand if, like, Christianity is supposed to be all about faith, all about peace and brotherly love and all these things. Why are so many people getting killed? Like, I couldn't. It was just too gory for me. And so I had to like actually put that part of history aside because I couldn't accept it. And then so then I turned to the scriptures. And that's when I was reading again about the councils, the different councils. And I was like, oh, yeah, my professor told me about this a long time ago. It was only then that I was like, hey, wait a minute. How come these people can choose what to put in the Bible? That doesn't sound right. You know, if this is a religion from God, shouldn't God be the one who's guiding all this, not a bunch of men who are choosing which books put in, which things take out? I was like, okay, this something's wrong. Something's not right about this. So even that part of history, even the Bible, I had to like put away a little bit. I couldn't accept that it was like, you know, put together like that. And so another book that changed me was when I was reading about Pauline theory, which is the predominant theory in Protestantism right now. So I was looking at Pauline theory, and I found out that Pauline theory wasn't even the popular theory at that time. So I was like, well, if Pauline theory wasn't the popular theory, so how come it was chosen? Why are they using this theory? Why are they using a theory of a man who persecuted Jesus, first of all, and changed a whole bunch of his teachings? Just from that, it's like, wait, what? but then I found out that the reason why they chose this theory was purely political. It was because of power struggle at that time with the church and of the state and all these things. And I was like, hey, hold on, this isn't right too. So eventually I didn't disbelieve yet. I was just like, okay, the Bible needs to be put aside, because obviously I don't understand something. And Christian history has to be put aside, because obviously I don't understand something. So now what do I look at? So then I thought, okay, here's what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. Since I'm not feeling fulfilled, there must be something else that I have to do, because I mean, God gave me a brain. I do have a master's degree. I can do something. So I thought, okay, Aliza, this is what you're going to do for the rest of your life. You're going to become a linguist. You are going to learn Koine Greek and Latin and Aramaic and Arabic and look at the original manuscripts so that you will know for yourself what in the world those things say, and you don't have to rely on other people. Then God will really lead you because you know what those things say. So I always imagine Allah looking down and be like, you silly little girl, how long is that going to take you? How many decades is that going to take you? I mean, quite quickly after that, I made friends with one Muslim person who prayed. This was
Aliza, before we talk, we go to the one Muslim lady who prayed. Generally, when we have a crisis of faith, okay, like someone like you, who are, I would say, very religious in nature, out of sudden, certain people, like Sheikh Yusuf Estes, he was a chaplain. Ultimately, what he did was, he would just ask God, God, please guide me. Just the emptiness, like you say, and I believe a lot of our audience today, those especially from, I mean, I felt the same thing. You know, I'm not as successful as you are, but as we grow older, I mean, not so old anyway, all those material things that we have in possessions, we look at it as if, what is all this about? You have car, you have house, you have family, but yet, deep inside you, there is an emptiness. The sort of emptiness that no matter what, no amount of money, no amount of properties, no amount of friends that can fill it up. And that is where we are going through the soul-searching journey. Now let's go back to your one Muslim friend who prayed.
So I had this one friend who prayed, and even they admitted, you know, they're not perfect Muslim, but at least they prayed. And even, and because I was already on this kind of research study and kind of trying to ground myself in my own faith, when I saw them praying, I thought that it was actually, I thought it was amazing. For me as a Christian, yeah, I prayed, but if I forget to pray for 2 months, it's okay. Nothing happens to me, you know, it's not a good thing, but nothing happens. So this friend of mine, I saw them praying 5 times a day, and I thought that was amazing to have this connection with God 5 times a day. They must have this, you know, pretty close, pretty good relationship if they can do that multiple times a day. So I remember seeing them whenever they went off to pray, I would pray. I would pray in my own way. So they were actually reminding me to reconnect with God. And I felt so happy with that, that I kind of like stuck with this friend for a little while. And it was actually this friend that introduced me to Al Khadim as well. They were actually going to Al Khadim at that time. I don't know if they go anymore, because halfway through when I was still going, they didn't go anymore, but I kept going. So I went, and the way that it was introduced to me, or the way that Islam was introduced to me, was that, hey, Aliza, I know that you're, you know, on this search to ground yourself. Don't you know that Islam is part of the same roots as Christianity and also Judaism? I was like, I must have learned that in that 30 minutes, but nope, I don't remember. So I was like, oh, interesting. Okay. All right. Since I am giving a chance to myself to have a full research study, I have to be open-minded and academic enough to take on also the teachings of Islam and see if there's any clues for me there. That's the way that I looked at it. You know, a holistic research. So I thought, okay, so I'll give this center a try. And I was quite shy, actually, because by that time I had realized that Muslim ladies dressed a little bit differently, more modestly, covered a whole lot more than I was covering at that time. And, you know, and you wanted to conduct yourself in a certain way. And alhamdulillah, I'm ethnically Thai, culturally Thai, so that, okay, so the politeness and everything, we can adjust. But the everything else, I wasn't sure how to act. So alhamdulillah, I was paired with a lady that was there to just sit with me, and that made me feel so much better. But once I sat down, I started to listen to Sheikh Hussein talk about, at that time he was talking about Prophet Ibrahim, actually. Yeah, I couldn't figure out who's this Ibrahim, even though it's so close to Abraham, but it didn't connect. But I knew that the story was so familiar. When I was listening to stories, I know these stories. These stories are so familiar, but how come these names are there? I don't know who these people are, but I know this story. And then the values that I was hearing, you know, the beautiful values of Islam. I always say that, you know, Christianity is like my bachelor's degree, but Islam is like my PhD in character building. Because this refinement of, you know, of these stories and the lessons and everything, I was like, this is really nice. You know, these values are something that I can really connect to, and I feel like I can own them. And even the adab that Sheikh Hussein was showing when he was teaching in class, I really enjoyed it. I really appreciated it, because the way that he speaks, and this is just how I see it, he's very grandfatherly like. He reminded me of my own grandfather, who's very soft spoken, loves to tell stories, smiles a lot, very, you know, very warm. And I really connected to that as someone who was feeling very shy and kind of scared of going. Having that sense of warmth and welcome and having these familiar stories was really nice for me. And so the first experience was nice. So I went again, and then I went again, and then I went again, and I kept going. And as in the middle of going all those times, Allah actually put together a series of booklets to be given to me. I say Allah because when I look at these booklets, every single booklet that was given to me was put in the perfect order to adjust my mind to be able to accept Tawheed all the way until who is Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So I didn't know it at that time. Of course, I was like, oh, this is interesting. This is interesting. Oh, this is interesting. You know, and so I just kept reading. I'm not an avid reader by any means. But during those times, from the time I woke up to the time that I slept, I could not stop reading. I was like, I felt like I was in a black zone. You know, I was like sucked in, like keep on getting sucked into everything. I really felt like that. And even some of those booklets, I was like, wow, God is playing some kind of joke on me right now. You know, because I'll give you an example. One of those books was given, they were talking about this phrase, the Son of God. And now I know that culturally the Jews would call anyone that is very righteous a son of God. But of course, anyone from any other tradition can take that out of context. I understand that now. But in that book, guess what languages they compared? They compared Koine Greek, Latin, Aramaic, Arabic, all those languages that I was like, I got to become a linguist and learn all these languages. It was in there. And I felt like God was answering that particular intention of mine. I was like, no, you don't have to go and do all that. Let me show you. And then you'll understand. And you don't have to waste 50 years of your life. I'll just show you now. So there was things like that that I was like, oh my God, I think God heard my prayer and answered it for me. So one thing led to another. I read books for 3 months until the point where I understood that Islam is a way of life. A religion, yes, it is a religion, but more so a way of life. And the Muslims are people who subscribe to this way of life. And it's a way of life where you're submitting yourself to Allah, you're submitting yourself to the pleasure of Allah. And that's exactly what I was trying to find, right? I was trying to find, how am I going to please God so that when He's pleased with me, He's happy with me, He'll make me happy as well. And so I realized that, okay, if Islam is this way of life, okay, I can accept that. And if this, you know, people who are in this way of life are called Muslims, I was also okay with that. I literally was okay with that. I was like, maybe I've been Muslim my whole life. I just didn't know that this is what it's called. I actually remember thinking that. And then the last step that I thought that I need to do was, I felt like a Muslim woman seems very busy. You know, she wakes up at like 5 something, has to pray, and then has to put on all this stuff. And, you know, I just throw on jeans and a tank top and a hoodie, right? So I was like, seems really time consuming, and I'm really busy filming, and can I do all of that? Because my worry was that I wouldn't be able to do everything well. So my personality type is like perfectionist. Like I need to do stuff well. Otherwise I feel uncomfortable. So I actually booked a volunteer and I was like, I'm going to follow this woman from the time she wakes up to the time she sleeps for 3 days to make sure that I can do everything. So it didn't get to that. The day that I was supposed to meet her, I was intercepted. And that's when I had my accidental shahada. And I always say that's my accidental shahada, not because it's an accident, but it's because I didn't plan it. It wasn't supposed to happen that day. I didn't plan it. Allah planned it. I was supposed to meet my volunteer and then the substitute teacher at Al Khadim, Ustaz Sharif. He's also American. I think he probably got wind of me. Some of the volunteers probably told him about me. And he was like, hey, Lisa, let's talk. I want to answer any questions that you might have. And in my mind at that time, I was like, dude, I already read all these things. I'm kind of okay. The only thing I want to know is that if I can like do this stuff that Muslim women can do or not in my mind, but I didn't say it out because I didn't want to be impolite. So politely, I said, yeah, okay, let's go talk. So we went into the living room at the center and sat down, and he was, you know, talking to me, and then he was like, okay, so Lisa, so what do you know about Islam? Okay, so I summarized it for him, and he was like, okay, so you know enough, so how come you're not a Muslim yet? So I was like, I mean, yeah, I told him, well, I actually feel like maybe I was Muslim my whole life. I just didn't know that it was called this. He was like, okay. And then, so what's holding you back? So actually there were some things that were holding me back. So there were three things, actually. The first one was my dad, because of course, as everyone now knows, he's someone who's known. So I was very worried about his social circles, what's going to happen to him, because I love my dad so much, you know, I don't want him to be affected by anything that I might do. The second one was I had such a close relationship with the persona of Jesus Christ, you know, that some of the new information that was coming was hard for me to digest. It was still a little bit difficult for me. And then number three, I had never learned anything about Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at all. So I was thinking, how am I supposed to accept him and love him and all these things if I don't know anything about him at all? So these things were kind of holding me back. So this American Ustadh, he started trying to push my buttons, and he kind of knew. The first one missed because he did a very American thing. He was like, oh, Lisa, you know all these things. You know, when you go out, you got to be careful. Don't get into an accident. Don't die, because then we know this trick, and it didn't work. That one I was like, yeah, okay. But then I think he realized my personality type, and he was like, Aliza, are you worried that you don't know enough? Something like that. And I was like, yeah, you know, I know that once you revert, you know, everything, like you have a blank slate, and I don't want to sin, and I want to know how to pray. I want to know how to recite in Arabic. I want to know how to speak Arabic. I want to know all these things. And he was like, do you know that most Muslims don't really know how to speak Arabic? And I was like, oh, really now? Okay. And then he was like, well, how long do you think that's going to take? Like 20 years? I was like, I'm not sure. And then he pushed this button. And this is the one, it might not sound logical to all of you, but it's like, it hurt me. Because like perfectionist, right? So he was like, you know, Lisa, Allah is only going to give the Muslims a certain level of knowledge. No matter how much you try, you're not going to get it because you haven't declared yourself. And I was like, what? So that means, like, if I read for 10 years, 20 years, I'm not going to have a level of understanding that I want. I couldn't really accept that. And I it was a shock at first because my personality. And then Allah caused me to understand something. And I always attribute everything to Allah, because it had never occurred to me until those moments, that even though I say that I feel like I've been Muslim my whole life, it's just lip service. Unless I actually declare myself, it's just lip service. That's it. It's just empty words, because I haven't actually done anything official. Anyone can say anything until you make it official. So how can I become qualified, or why would I be worthy to get that depth of knowledge if I'm just giving lip service? I understood that in a moment, you know, and I cried because I wanted to be perfect. I was scared a little bit, because I knew that Allah at that moment was starting to pull me. I could feel it. because the next thought, and I had never thought of it, that's why I always say Allah. Allah made me think that number two, if he wants me to do something, can I stop it? And the obvious answer is no, cannot. So if God wants me to do something, if God wants to be a Muslim, I can't stop it. Oh no, what about my dad? And then the next thought, well, if God wants me to be this and he's pulling me in, there's absolutely no reason why he's not going to help me with my family as well. Absolutely no reason. So all of those things put together, and I always get chills. The chills are coming now. All of those reasons put together, and I think Ustaz Sharif must have seen it on my face or something, because then he asked me, are you ready now? And I said, yes, I'm ready now, because Allah prepared me in those moments. He knew that he knew that I wanted the understanding, the peace, the knowledge. He knew I wanted that grounding. He knew that I was scared that my dad would be unhappy and hurt. He gave me the reassurance. He knew all of these things inside my heart and put it inside my mind to understand in those moments. So there was nothing left that I could say except for yes. So yeah, that was my accidental shahada, because it was absolutely unplanned. And I tell you, the rest is, I mean, the first 2 months were really amazing as well. But just to finish the shahada story is that I didn't want a high profile shahada. I didn't want the whole world to know yet. I wanted it to be between me and Allah, because I wanted to make sure that I improve myself and work on myself first, because I knew that if I was under the eye of the public or too many people, that would be a pressure that would be insincere to me. So I wanted to do everything for Allah. So I remember I had maybe three ladies who came in from the other room, and then three brothers. Two of them were my witness, and then is the sharif. And I said my shahada in English, in Arabic, following him with very bad pronunciation. I remember it was a struggle for me, and then in English. And once I was done saying it in English, there was this intense tingling from the top of my head. I felt the wave. It was from the top of my head, and it washed over my whole body. And every time I say this, I feel that tingling again. And I really felt that old life being washed away. And I heard that buzz, you know, like when the TV station goes out at night, it's like, like that. I heard that in my ears. Everything was like that. And then everything was sepia for a moment. Everything looked sepia. And then joy. Absolute peace and joy for 2 full months, until people were asking me, what the heck is wrong with you, Lisa? Why are you so happy? But yeah, so that was the day that I took my shahada. Sorry, I know that I talk a lot, but yeah, I really enjoy telling this story.
Aliza, this is not the first day I know you. You know, when you are sharing about your reversions, just for your information, Aliza, there is a sister in one of my Facebook. She commented that, you know, she has the same surname like you. Her name is Mawar Kim. Okay, you are Aliza Kim. She is Mawar Kim. Okay, so she sent her salam to you, and of course, a reverse sister as well, who has texted me as well, that they are watching these conversations, and they felt so inspired by your story. And when you talk about your reversions, where accidental reversion, this sister, she is currently watching. I will not name her, because she's still, this will bring me to the next questions to you, basically. Has been searching for the truth for the past few years. And then last year, she texted me somewhere around May, I guess, somewhere around May. Okay, she's texted me on in IG, Instagram. Then I invited her to come and meet me. But unfortunately, due to unforeseen circumstances, she could not come and meet me to discuss. But anyhow, we keep in touch on WhatsApp. We have a lot of exchange conversations. And just like what you say, Sheikh Sharif is also my teacher. He's the one who, I think you became Muslim in 2013. Which month was that?
January.
And then he's the one who conduct our Dawah training program, DTP, in Home of Hope in July, 1st until 3rd. Okay. So the technique that he used again to you is the same technique that he have taught us. and then when I talk to this sister, this particular sister, I can sense that I'm a salesman anyway. We know what is called buying signal, interested or not. She have almost the same concern like you. But I know that somehow or rather, I need to do something to so-called, unquote, to force her to make the decisions. Because there are some people who are on the edge, but there are so many concerns, which is a valid concern. But sometimes when they just think a little bit, hey, some people say, I want to be a Muslim, but I do not want to be a Muslim now. I should wait for my parents to pass away, then only I become Muslim, so I don't hurt their feelings. But then, when I ask them, sister, brother, what is the reason that you love and you want to become a Muslim? That you want to become a Muslim because you believe Islam is the truth? Meaning, you believe Islam is the truth, and you want to go to paradise, and you don't want to go to the hellfire. And then they say, yes. How can you say, you claim, you love your family, you love your parents, and yet you wait for them to die first without having any chances for you to talk to them about Islam? They start to think very long. Same thing, just to cut the story short. The sister is still texting me. She's so inspired by your talk. For a few days consecutive, I have to force her. I say it's now or never. And then one fine day, she just texts me and she say, brother, I'm ready. And during that time, we are having our lockdown, you know, and then she say, how to do it? I say, no worry. I can't meet you, you can't meet me. We can do it over video call, WhatsApp video call. And then I call her, but before I call her, she say, just wait for a while. Let me take my shower. Let me put my headscarf on, and then let's do it. And then when I call her, because before she become Muslim, I already told her. Just like what you say, the tingerings, you know, the wave, and you feel the sense of the burden are being lifted off from your shoulder. So I have told her all this feeling before she became Muslim. When I guide her to recite the Shahada, Ashhadu Alla ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammada Rasulullah. Each of the words that I guide her and she follow up with the repetitions, she can't stop crying. It's very emotional for her. And then after we have completed the entire Shahada sessions, the testimony of faith, you know, she keep on apologizing to me because she can't hold back her tears. And then I say, it's okay, cry. This is the joy, the tears of joy. And you deserve it. Okay, and you need this. And then she told me, brother, what you told me really is really true. You know what? Now I felt so light. You know, the burden has gone off from my shoulder. It just out of sight that all the burden have gone. And she's watching right now.
Mashallah.
She's watching right now.
Mashallah.
And wish to meet you one day. Inshallah. Okay,
Inshallah.
The sister, you know who you are. The sister who text me, you know who you are. You know, inshallah, you're gonna meet Aliza one day, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Okay. Having said so, she's struggling. Currently, she's struggling how to break the news to the family. Can you assist her to share your own experience? How do you break your news to your beloved father?
Okay. So, alhamdulillah, the way that I told my family was pure strategy. Really pure strategy, and it's something that I actually tell to a lot of college students when I do the sharing there. Whenever you want to tell your family, especially your parents, something, you can't do it cold turkey. It's too much of a shock, especially when you've changed so much or you need to tell them something serious. You have to strategize, and the first thing you have to understand is your parents' personality. I really had to understand what my parents would be worried about in me, you know, if I were to change and become a Muslim. So I knew that, for example, okay, so for me, I only focused on my dad because my dad is very good at explaining things to my mom. So if I tell dad tells mom, that's always the best chain in my family. Okay, so I had to really focus on my dad and what he would be worried about. as a religious person, he would be worried about, of course, my hereafter, what's going to happen to me when I die as a Muslim. But after that, is interestingly enough, my dad would actually be interested in women's rights. He's very interested in women's rights. And so I had to think of little drops of information that I could drop. Oh, hey, I learned that Islam teaches this about women. Little drop, you know, just to prep him that, oh, I'm learning something. So that's what I did. I understood my dad's personality first, my family's personality first, and then I started to craft my timeline. I actually gave myself one full year to learn, to adjust, to become a better person, and also to equip myself with enough basic information to be able to answer any questions that he might ask me. Because that's really important, you know, because if someone asks you, why did you become a Muslim and this and that, and you don't really have a good answer, they'll have even more questions. But if you are able to at least answer a little bit, then they'll understand, okay, she thought about this. This is something that, you know, was thought through, and it's something that, you know, she wants, like really wants, without being, you know, misled in some way. So yeah, first thing is understand your parents' personality. Second thing, like what I said, is understand those topics that they might be worried about. You know, some parents might be worried about food. They might be worried about your dressing. How are you going to fit in with other people? Some parents might be worried about how are you going to get married? You know, all these things. I knew that my dad was worried about women's rights. Am I going to be oppressed? Am I going to be bullied? All these things. So I started to drop little things like that. I dropped little hints for about 3 months. And then when my dad came to visit me, I had... So by 3 months, I had dropped enough to be like, okay, I think I have to tell him a little bit more. So when he actually came, I had planned a meeting with my teacher, who is Sheikh Hussein at that time. I had to choose only Sheikh Hussein, because when you want to introduce someone to your parents, you should introduce someone that is somehow on par with them, someone that they also can respect and connect to. So if I had chosen someone very young like Firdaus, my dad might be like, young whippersnapper, what's he teaching my daughter?
I know your address. I will send a news to you, inshallah.
Yeah? Yeah, so anyway, so yeah, I chose Sheikh Hussein because they're of similar age. Even though they're scholars of different religions, they have similar amounts of information of their respective religions. They will have, you know, enough knowledge to be able to discuss things. And not only that, their other similarity is that they're very soft-spoken, both of them. And plus, I was so scared. I was so scared. I just needed someone there to be with me that I trusted and who I knew would be able to choose the right words to say to my dad. So I was so scared. So I decided that I needed to introduce my dad to Sheikh Hussein so that he will know that I'm learning from someone proper, not someone extreme, not someone who's going to misguide me, but just someone who is nice, teaching me good things, teaching me how to improve my life, things like that. I still didn't tell my dad that I had reverted yet, no, because I didn't feel that he was ready yet, but he was ready for me to tell him at least that, okay, dad, I'm kind of learning more about Islam, and this is my teacher. And I remember in that moment when I told him and he had met Sheikh Hussein, I saw the tears brimming in his eyes. And it was like a daughter's worst nightmare. You know, I'm a daddy's girl, and I saw his eyes turning red, and I was crying so hard, but I had to try to hide it, because then he'd be like, what's wrong with this girl? I thought, you know, if she wants this, why is she like sad, right? So, but I was like, no, I'm okay. Yeah, this is my teacher. No, but yeah, so I told him, you know, that I'm learning about Islam, and I'm learning from this teacher, and he's teaching me good things. And if you have any questions about what I'm learning, he will answer for you. Or if you don't know what to ask now, just write a list for me and I will get all of your questions answered, because that is so important. When your parents don't understand, that's where the fear will come in, that's where the misunderstandings will come in, that's where all the problems will come in, when they don't understand. Either they don't understand what you're learning, or they don't understand exactly what you're doing and why you're doing it. So these questions you need to kind of think about and prepare how you're going to answer your parents, because this is the next thing, and this is one of the biggest thing. You have to realize that your parents love you so much that one of the biggest fears that they're going to have, and one of the biggest reasons that they're going to get upset at you, is because inside their heart they're thinking, am I losing my little girl? Is she going to become someone that who I don't know? I love my little girl so much. Is she becoming something that I don't even know and I don't even understand? So you have to be able to show them that you're the same person, but even better. So that's what I did next. The very next day after introducing him to Sheikh Hussein, I took him on a father-daughter date. I took him to Malacca, where he's always wanted to go. And I fed him fantastic food.
And well, the best place.
Yes. So you know, right? A happy man is a well-fed man. So, and then whenever it was time to pray, I made it very easy. I would just, you know, Dad, we've been walking for some time. How about you sit here in this air-conditioned place, have a drink, and I'll be right back. So then I will go off for a few minutes, pray, and come back. And he'd be perfectly happy. He'd be drinking his drink, looking at the people. Didn't even realize what I went to do, you know. So I made it as easy as possible, you know, and I bought him souvenirs and all these things. I showed him a good time. So by the end of the day, he realized that, yeah, she's still the same. She might be learning some things, but she's improving herself and she's still my daughter. So he was very happy at the end of the day. And he left that trip very happy as well. So calming your parents down, answering some of those initial feelings, especially the feelings. Sometimes it's not even the questions yet, it's addressing their feelings. That will help a lot. So then, because my dad is also an intellectual, he has 2 master's degrees and a PhD. it's hard to trump my dad. But I figured, okay, my dad is a thinker. I've given him enough for him to know what's going on. He's going to be able to, you know, adjust and digest some of these things that I've given him. So that was basically towards the middle of the year that he came to visit. So for this next 6 months, I just dropped little things here and there. And at the same time, I was already putting on the hijab 90% of the time, you know, adjusting myself in every way until December. So December is my deadline. And Dad usually comes to visit me during Christmas vacation. You know, as a Christian family, that's what you do, right? So Dad was planning to come and see me. And I had already been wearing hijab by that time, 99% of the time. And stopping my modeling contracts and all these things, you know, and really getting ready. January, that's it. Full Islamic lifestyle. So it was time. And I remember it was like he was here already like a week. And I was like, oh my gosh. So hard to start talking. So I thought, all right, fine. I will take him shopping, or at least window shopping, and I will feed him a fantastic tea time, again with the food, and then I'll tell him. So I took him to one of the shopping centers here, a big shopping center. And again, I don't know why we ate Nyonya food again. I don't remember, but anyway, we ate Nyonya food again. And towards the end, I had to muster all of my bravery because he's going to leave next day. And I said to him, you know, Dad, I really need to update you about me and Islam. And that was literally all I said. I need to update you about me and Islam. And then my dad said, okay, wait. And inside me, I was like, oh my God, what's he going to say? Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And he was like, okay, wait. And then he said the most beautiful thing that a man in his position, in his work, in his fatherly role could have possibly said to me. he said to me, you know, Aliza, religion has a purpose. And the purpose of religion is to anchor your heart and to give you peace. And if this religion gives you peace, you go ahead. I'm not going to stop you. And you don't have to worry about me. And you don't have to worry about our family, because in our family, we have Christians, we have Catholics, we have Buddhists, and now we have a Muslim. So you don't worry if you need to do this. This is the summary. But oh my God, is that the most beautiful thing that he could possibly say? It was so beautiful. But I'll tell you my secret for how we got here. On that very first day when I became a Muslim, the day that I took my Shahada, immediately after I met my volunteer, and then I met the other ladies that she brought along with her, and they were basically, I mean, the first time I offered Salah was at Al Khadim. Actually, I offered Salah looking like this the whole time. It's like, what am I supposed to do next? Sujood is all like, oh, okay, they're standing up, you know? But then like my actual real Salah after, like, okay, I kind of know the movements now, were with these ladies. And with those ladies, one of them, alhamdulillah, she was my first female imam. She also taught me that one of the best times to ask for anything from Allah is when you're in sujood. And that was that. I kept it in my heart. And every single salah, for as much as far as I can remember, with all sincerity, every single salah, and I never missed a salah. I might have been late a little bit in the beginning as I was adjusting, or you know, if I was stuck in traffic, you know, these things are unavoidable. But I never missed a salah, and the reason why I never missed a salah, because I was so in need of Allah's approval and also His answer to my dua that I made in every single salah, which I still remember the words because I said it thousands of times. I said, Ya Allah, please soften my parents' heart to accept me as a Muslim daughter. And I said this over and over and over again for one full year. And the fruits of that one full year of that exact dua, oh my God, chills again, is my dad saying those beautiful words. Those are the fruits. So if anyone is also struggling, if you're thinking to tell your parents, please make dua after dua after dua. One is not going to cut it. Five is not going to cut it. 50 is not going to cut it. Especially anything that you are scared of. And I was so scared. I needed my parents to love me so much. And I'm sure you do too. So no, however scared you are and however much you need it, you got to make that many dua. Not one, not two, not five, hundreds, thousands if you need to. Keep saying the dua and Allah will answer you. As long as your heart is pure and your heart is sincere, Allah will answer you. He will answer you in a way that is the most beautiful way. You just have to be patient for it. It took me one full year. One full year. I don't know how long it's going to take you, but it will happen. It will happen. You just have to trust the process. Okay, so you have one process that's for your dad or your family, and then you have another process that is purely for Allah. And these two things together, that's where you're going to find your success.
Inshallah. Aliza, we have a lot of questions here, but unfortunately, time is not on our side. Okay. And of course, for the audience who first time listening to Aliza or first time knowing her, we should know that there is no short answer from Aliza. And where she will give you the short answer is that, would you like to go for lunch? Yes. That's it. Okay. Other than that, okay, do not expect Aliza, okay, to give you a short answer. Good in storytelling, as most of you can witness today. Okay. She's good in captivating your mind, okay, and paying your attentions. Okay. Having said so, Aliza, there is one sister here by the name of Anusha. She asked a question. Assalamualaikum, sister. Along the way in your journey in Islam, how did you overcome the challenges from the environment and family? Can you also share some books for new viewers? It's totally motivating to hear your story. Sister Anusha.
Okay, Assalamu alaikum, Sister Anusha. Thank you so much for the question. How did I deal with the environment, especially with my family? Actually, I didn't live with my family. I lived alone. So I was blessed in that way. I didn't have that challenge. I didn't, you know, so I can't really answer that part of it. But yeah, my environment, if we're talking about how I adjusted with my career, I basically stopped my career for the sake of Allah, because I felt like what I was doing at that time was not going to get me to Jannah. You know, my modeling and all that stuff, I felt that it was counterproductive to my, I mean, our goal is to get to paradise, right? So I didn't feel like it was going to get me there. But the beautiful thing is, Sister Anusha, that if you give up something for the sake of Allah, Allah will give it something else back to you that's even better. And what I got back was Islamic content. So I still got to do all of my TV stuff, all of my video stuff. I'm still in the media, but in a way that is Islamic and beautiful and fulfilling for me. So talking about environment in that way. In terms of books, I don't really have any special books that for new Muslims, although I'm planning to write some, so maybe you can look for mine. How about that? How about that? But what I can say is that the thing that inspired me so much as a new Muslim was learning about other new Muslims, hearing their stories, just sharing, you know, other revert stories, their struggles, how they adjusted, and having good friends who are going through the same thing. That really helps, having that support system. So more than the books that will inspire you, just you, but having, you know, finding a support system and finding other stories that are similar to yours will make you feel supported. And that will actually carry you a lot further than just reading a book alone. Yeah.
Quick one. We have a lot of questions. Okay. Sister Munira Aminullah. Assalamu alaikum, sister. Have you ever missed your previous lifestyle before became a Muslim? If you have, what do you do to remain steadfast in Islam? Thank you.
Thank you for the question, sister. Walaikum salam wa rahmatullah. I wouldn't say, no, I can't really say that I missed that lifestyle, because I felt so empty, you know? I think you remember from my story, I just felt so lost and empty and didn't know what I was doing, you know? It's only some pops. You know, there are some pops of time that I will remember some things that I used to enjoy. Like, you can't avoid it. You're going to the supermarket and you hear some song from the 90s and you're like, oh, this is my jam. Don't dance. Don't dance. Hold everything down. Don't sing. Don't dance. Don't do anything. So there will be times like that, you know, and I'll remember, you know, songs that I used to sing in the a cappella group and all this kind of thing. And I mean, those are enjoyable times. But if we're talking about the lifestyle, no, not really, sis, because I remember how empty I was. I remember how unhappy I was. Now I have a way to think in Islam where it's always supporting me and helping me through problems and also even increasing my happiness. So I don't particularly miss it. And plus, like I said, Allah has already given me back all of my media stuff. This really makes me very happy, all of my media stuff. So,
and more coming soon, right?
Inshallah, Ameen.
Wait for the announcements, yeah? Inshallah. Yeah, sure. Okay, now I have to ask these questions. So I have to ask, because these questions is coming from our brother Abu Abdullah Said, aka Brother Kalim. Okay. and she have make a wow to me that she said, he say that, okay, since tonight gonna be in English, I'm gonna watch it. Okay, so cool. Okay, so he asked, Sister Aliza, can you please share your experience on choosing to wear hijab and how it liberates a woman, please?
Alhamdulillah. Okay, this is a great question and I love to answer it, and it's gonna be long. No, I'll try to make it short. Okay, so I think my view of hijab maybe is very different from other people, simply because I was a model, right? So I was a model. I was in the industry. I was a clothes hanger, basically. I was a clothes hanger with no choices or anything like that. So when I started to wear the hijab again, or not again, when I started to wear the hijab, the first thing that struck me was like, wow, I'm learning how to dress myself again. I'm actually learning what I like again and how I want. I'm choosing how I want to look and not how other people want me to look. And that's just like a small taste of society. I mean, if you think about it, you know, women grow up with other people telling them what is acceptable, how you're supposed to look. What is acceptable in that culture? You know, some cultures, they like meatier women. Some cultures, they like really tiny women. Some cultures, you know, they love women with short hair. And, you know, society really tells you what you're supposed to look like. And especially, I tell you now, my view on fashion is that fashion is actually marketing. And if you ask any fashion house, they will tell you fashion is marketing, because these, you know, fashion industry, they will plan for an entire year what color you're going to wear next year, what cut you're going to wear next year, what kind of fabric you're going to wear next year. So all this is marketing. We think that it's impromptu and so trendy, and no, it was all planned actually. So for me, no such thing as fashion. There's only such a thing as personal style. And that's the beautiful thing that I got back with wearing the hijab. And I tell you, it was so freeing. So if we're talking about women's liberation, wow. The hijab freed me from all of those expectations that society was trying to put on me. What should my hair look like? What should my body look like? I need to have a bikini, four pack, whatever, whatever it was, you know. All, I mean, it's good to be healthy. It's good to be healthy, but the liberation of not having that pressure was amazing, because now I was choosing on my own terms, what am I going to look like? How am I going to express myself through my garments? Because I really actually believe in this thing called personal style. It is an expression of who you are. It's an extension of you. So I really got to experiment, and I must have watched like thousands of hijab tutorials until I got like my style. And plus, I have this weird face shape. I tell you, I don't wear this because it was the first choice. No, I'm not wearing.
Aliza, let me ask you, who started this trend? You or Marianne?
Me. I taught Marianne how to sew it.
So Marianne follow you. So you become a trendsetter. Okay, so now I know what to say to Marianne.
No, it's because I think we both have long faces, and I tell you, I tried my best to wear the normal one and it kept going back. And I was like, okay, this is not working. So I wore the triangle one, and then my face looked like a diamond. And I was like, this is weird. So then I'm like, I actually saw some styles from Indonesia, and they have this sideways thing. I was like, oh, this stays in place and it looks cute. I'll stay with this. So this is how I got to this style. But it was, I really tried my best, folks, to really wear the normal round one. It just did not work out. But yeah, I not only that, but the liberation in terms of intellectual liberation was also there. And let me tell you how. When I was a clothes hanger, my words didn't matter. What I thought didn't matter. What my opinion was didn't matter. What mattered was what my client thought. And because I was a clothes hanger, even if I was talking about something intellectual, people were looking at different areas of me and not at my face. And I'm this person who has an education and has an opinion, obviously likes to talk. So I want someone to actually hear my voice and hear my thoughts when I'm talking to them. Having the hijab on and covering certain parts, it gave me my voice back. And because I had my voice back, I had my inner self back. And that was beautiful. That is beautiful. Now people, okay, maybe they see my hijab thing first, and then they hear my voice. But I mean, the attention that people give me to my voice and to my thoughts now is something that I didn't get before, because there was other distractions, you know? So the hijab freed me not only from society, but it also freed me from being objectified. So now that I am put in the place where I want to be, I want to be someone who is heard. I want to be someone who is able to use my voice for good and for impact, you know? And I'm in, alhamdulillah, that's what the hijab gave me.
Maybe we go to the last question before we go to the conclusion. Is that okay, Aliza?
Okay, all right.
For me personally, this is very interesting questions. And I think this is where you're going to spend at least 5 minutes, I guess. I guess. All right. Okay. Brother Muhammad Abu Bakar, he asked, and since I believe that this show might be watched by our not yet Muslim brothers and sisters now, or maybe after this in a repeat show. Now, and this is very relevant to our talk today. Why is for people who are interested to know more about Islam?
Okay, so this is a bit tricky because Christians will feel very defensive, but I always feel that Christians, because we have, okay, I say we because I was a Christian, but in Christianity, there's a very strong feeling now in these times of this brotherly love, of gentleness, of generosity. So if you are able to speak to a Christian, I believe, in a way where you show similarities first, this will actually open up a lot of doors. If you're able to make a friendship first, see the similarities first, discuss the stories of the prophets, the overlapping values and all of these kinds of things, it actually opens a lot of doors. I remember some Catholic and Christian people that I know who, you know, I've developed a relationship with through the years, they will also tell me, you know, Elisa, if more people knew, wow, Christianity and Islam is so similar in so many ways. And I said, yeah. And then you can talk about, you have credit now. You know, there's a psychology theory. You have to put in enough credits first, and then you're able to give a criticism or a point that is differing. So now you have your points that are similar and you have a relationship. Now you can have a civil and good and, you know, two-way communication where not just like one way bashing. You can have now a two-way communication where you can say, oh, this is different and this is different. And you're able to give them thoughts, you know, things to think about, nuggets to think about, because that's really where it starts, right? It's like seeing the similarities and then being able to accept that, okay, there's some differences and, oh, I can see why there's differences. And then it goes from there. That's my personal style. That's what I found is better than, you know, going at each other's throats from the beginning. If you're able to start a conversation, well, that will take you places.
Great. So now, Aliza, we are coming to the end. And of course, when I look at the trend of those who watch, you know, from the beginning, on average, we have no less than 200 people is watching, alhamdulillah, no less than that, which is considered to be good for me, alhamdulillah. Okay, because my Facebook pages are not known for English speaking, because most of my content, or I would say majority of my content, are in Bahasa. But now today we are having, I would say this might be the less than five times I conduct a English interview or talk show on my Facebook. But alhamdulillah, I think majority of them tune in to listen to your story.
MashaAllah. Yes.
Alhamdulillah. Now, Aliza, 1.5 hours have passed, but personally, I felt that, you know, every time when I talk to you, we ever felt that, you know, 1.5 hours is just like 3 minutes ago. Okay, now, coming to the end, the conclusions. And a lot of people, they want to laugh before the conclusion. But basically, the conclusions also sometimes can be equally important to the content that we have shared, right? So in conclusions, Aliza, you have given some advice to those people who have, you know, who have interest in Islam. I mean, sometimes, as a reward, people look up to us as their inspirations to become a better Muslim. As I can see in some, and I can read in some of the comments, they say, as a Muslim, they feel ashamed with your commitment toward Islam from the day you became Muslim and how you reached this stage. Now, rather than the advice to the not yet Muslim in which you already gave just now, what would be your advice to inspire the born Muslim to become a better Muslim and, you know, hopefully, ultimately, to enter Jannah?
Okay. Wow, this is a different twist than what I usually get, but alhamdulillah. The answer is actually not so different. For alhamdulillah, my Muslim brothers and sisters who were born into Muslim families, you know, you don't have to feel ashamed, because MashaAllah, Allah loves you so much that He's calling you now. You have to realize that this discomfort that you're feeling, that's Allah calling you right now. This is your opportunity. He sees that you're ready now. All you have to do is remember all of those things that you actually learned when you were a child, or maybe you're reviving now. It's okay to relearn things. You know, it's okay to learn the basics again, to review again, to learn all of these things again. And it's okay to go slowly. Everyone has their own pace. And you have your own pace too. You might feel like, oh my God, Lisa, but I'm already 40 years old, 50 years old. I have to go faster. I've been Muslim for so many decades already. Yeah, but Allah sees that your time is right now. It wasn't 30 years ago. It's right now. So it's okay. This is your time now. And you have to keep your eyes on the goal. Your eyes have to be on the goal, which is Jannah. Jannah is the place that we all want to go. We don't want to go to other place. No, we don't want to go to other place for sure. No, we want to go to Jannah because let's face it, we have had so much pain in our lives. And I don't talk about my issues that much, but even, you know, I have lots of problems. I'm sure that you have problems and you have faced problems in your life now. And maybe that's also why Allah is calling you now, because you need that help. You know that Jannah is the place where there are no tears. Jannah is the place where there's no one that is going to speak bad words to you. Jannah is the place where everyone is going to be nice to you. No one is going to be unjust to you. You're not going to be sick. You're going to be healthy. It's the place where you get to see all the people that you love all the time, even those people that you have already lost. You're going to see those people again. That's the place where we want to be. That's the thing that you need to keep your eyes on. That is your goal. Now, we work backwards. Just like when we set a goal for work, we work backwards. We know the goal. Now we have to see what are the things that are going to get us to that goal. Do your checklist first. Are you completing the pillars? Are you praying on time? If you're not, do that first. Are you fasting during Ramadan? If you're not doing that, do that first. Get all of the pillars first, and after that, you start doing all the other things. You know, for some people, reading Quran is so easy for them, and it's so beautiful and enjoyable. Maybe for you, it won't be. Maybe for you, it'll be easy for you to wake up a little bit earlier and pray tahajjud. So do that. Set your alarm clock 30 minutes before and pray tahajjud. Work backwards and add in one thing at a time. Don't add in 10 things at a time, because you have to know. One thing at a time, make it into a habit. We know that what, 20 days is a habit, yeah? Make it into a habit, all right? One thing at a time, take your time. Remember that Allah wants us to be istiqamah. He wants the small things, you know, but consistent. So do that. Remember, don't be disheartened. This is your time. Keep your eyes fixed on your goal. Work backwards and add in one small step at a time. And inshallah, I hope that we will all get to Jannah. I pray that we all get to Jannah and that we're able to do enough to gain Allah's mercy, because that's the only way that we're going to get into Jannah is by His mercy. And just do as best as you can, because your level best will always be enough.
MashaAllah. Beautiful conclusions.
Alhamdulillah.
I do not think that I could add on anything on top of what you have just said. Alhamdulillah. Jadi sahabat-sahabat yang telah menonton sejak dari awal lagi ataupun yang baru bermula dan sebagainya, jangan risau, anda boleh menonton semula ulangannya selepas ini insyaAllah, dan juga boleh kongsikan kepada sahabat-sahabat anda yang mungkin berminat, ya, yang sedang mencari ataupun tidak mencari, tetapi moga dengan asbab kita berkongsikan video ini, mereka terdetik untuk berfikir, ya, dan kemudian menerusi anda, mereka menemui hidayah. Sebagaimana sabda Nabi SAW, barang siapa, jikalau Allah SWT memberikan hidayah kepada seseorang melalui engkau, adalah jauh lebih baik daripada seekor unta merah. Jadi jangan malu untuk berkongsikan ini selepas berakhirnya, kongsi kepada kawan-kawan anda. Semoga ianya bermanfaat untuk mereka dan untuk diri kita, insyaAllah. Jadi sehingga kita berjumpa pada minggu hadapan, Rabu hadapan, kita juga akan ada tetamu yang istimewa setiap hari Rabu 9:30 malam dalam program Perspektif bersama Prof. Fidaus. Jadi sehingga kita jumpa lagi pada Rabu depan. Jadi we end with tasbih kafarah. Subhanahu wa bihamdika. Asyhadu la ilaha illa ant wa astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.